Hello everyone, welcome to Payments Live. We have an office hour star show today answering questions from Stack Overflow groups and the moderator. But before doing that, we'll do something special. Here in the studio with me is my colleague Bong. Bong,
hey,
hi to everyone. And what we are doing is, as we're getting close to the end of a great year for Google Payments and Wallet APIs, and since this will be the last show until next year, we thought let's do a recap of all the important events and launches that happened in 2012. So let's get started. Just as we crossed into 2012, we launched the international version of the Digital Goods API, or the INA Payments. And that came with availability in 18 countries and 9 currencies. And it was a nice new present, and we made quite international developers very happy. What happened next?
And shortly after we launched that, we also made a few additional improvements to that digital purchase flow. We've added a streamlined signup, we call it main address signup, and it makes it a very seamless experience to purchase virtual goods from within the app. So we simplified sign-up for in-app payments.
So now even the sign-up was in-app. That's pretty cool. And along the way, we also had some cool developer conferences and events where we met a lot of developers. We talked about monetizing apps with Google Wallet. And among those, some of the most important were the Google Developer Conference, the GitHub Developer Conference, and South by Southwest, both happening early spring. And they're coming again this spring in 2013, and we may have some cool things to talk about. So stay tuned for announcements. We try to post announcements in advance on this show.
Yep. And then in March and April, we also announced mobile web support for the in-app payments API. And what this means is that you can just integrate once, and you will be able to accept purchases on the desktop and mobile devices. Well, the mobile web. We also launched a Google Plus page for Google Wallet to keep you up to date on the latest Google Wallet news. And in June, at Google I.O., we had a few other great new announcements. We launched subscription support and the new pricing structure with fees as low as 1.9%. Oh, and we also announced Save to Wallet for offers.
Lots of announcements at I.O. That's very nice. And then the summer came, and what did we do? We took a vacation? Not really. So just right after Google I.O., we launched this show on Google Developers Live. And it's an amazing way to reach developers in all parts of the world. We hold office hours and have speaker guests along the way. We try to give you a sneak preview into things to come, and to name just a few, we showed you the new Merchant Center, and also the new commerce analytics features. And all these are very nice new features that will come in the coming months.
Yep. And then in August, we did something new. We moved the concept of Google Wallet into the cloud. So now, instead of digitally representing your credentials on your phone or your device, we're now storing digital representation in the cloud, and the benefit of that is that it's now accessible from any device connected to the clouds, or even offline sometimes, depending on the device, that supports Google Wallet. So anywhere that you want to purchase from, whether it's your mobile phone, whether it's your tablet, whether it's your PC, on any purchase flow that supports Google Wallet, you can make a purchase using the same credentials across all of those things.
That was pretty cool. That was one big step forward. And you used to have only one card available on Google Wallet. Now you can add any of them. And the cloud gives you so many more security enhancements and new features.
Yep.
And you know, with all those things going along, we kept in touch with the developers through our Payments Live show. But we also like to meet face-to-face. And in early fall, we had quite a few conferences where, again, we met with developers and talked about wallet APIs. And we had a lot of what we call DevFests, sponsored by Google and local developer communities in Washington, D.C. and in Mountain View, California. Met a lot of people there. If you're watching, hi. later on, Pong, you met with quite a few people in Kansas City.
Yep.
And these are all great ways to connect with developers, and we'll make sure to let you know about any upcoming events.
And finally, around the end of, closer to the end of the year, we announced a new mobile wallet API for mobile web transactions. And what it does is it enables OAuth to like access to payment credentials. Currently, it's only available to select merchants, but we're accepting new merchants every day, and you can request via merchants on our site at developers.google.com/wallet-online.
And, of course, we kept announcing more and more mobile devices that come preloaded with Google Wallet. And the last few we mentioned in previous shows are from the Nexus line, phones and tablets from Samsung and LG. And let's see, so we got closer to the end of the year. What else? Oh, on the developer support front, we are now focusing and have centralized the support to Stack Overflow. And this is where we'll actually take some questions today.
Yep.
And you know, on Stack Overflow, please make sure you only use technical questions. If they're too generic or not on technical topics, they may not be accepted.
Yeah, they may get closed out by the community or downvoted into oblivion.
Yep. All right, so what a great year. With that, let's move on with the Q&A section. So let me start with the first question. We had quite a few on Google Checkout, and this one involves the carrier card based shipping API, a very nice feature of Checkout. And the question is, I'm using the Checkout carrier shipping API. I have three shipping methods set up, and they work fine. I added a new set of products, and for those, the Checkout order page only shows the default shipping cost. So obviously, your carrier calculated shipping methods are not applying to these new products. It should be relatively easy to debug and test this in the sandbox, because you can then complete the entire transaction. You don't just stop at the order page. And then you can analyze the shopping cart received by Google and try to figure out why only the default shipping cost is applied. But if you cannot do that, since this is happening only for those new items, that's a pretty good indication that there's something probably wrong with those. There's some missing or incorrect data in the inventory when you added them to your database. And to give you a way to start investigating, please know that carrier calculated shipping needs the item weight in order to calculate the total shipping cost, because carriers calculate cost based on weight. And most likely you have weights missing on those items. And that's why by default they're zero, and then carrier calculated shipping will use the default cost. And another thing to make sure regarding the weights is that the total weight of the package will have to be at least a quarter pound in order for carrier calculated shipping to apply. So if you have smaller items, just set them to 0.25 pounds, a quarter pound, and then the shipping methods will kick in. So I think probably this is what's happening, and you'll figure it out.
Yeah, seems like it. I've seen a lot of the issues, and most of them are related around the weight.
It's easy to miss, and when you're adding new items to inventory, it's easy to miss the weights or add smaller weights than it's actually the case.
True. I'll take a second question. So I have trouble with taxes and checkout. The taxes set in the merchant center are not applied. And then I've seen this a few times before as well. And what's typically occurring here is that I'm guessing that the merchant is using an e-commerce platform, and then e-commerce platforms also sometimes can include their own tax rules. And these tax rules that are defined within the shopping cart XML that your platform is sending over the checkout overwrites the tax rules that are defined within checkout. So you're probably seeing the default tax rules that the e-commerce platform is providing. To get rid of this or to fix this, you have two options. You can either fix the tax table or update the tax table within your e-commerce platform, or you could ask your e-commerce provider how to remove the tax rules from the cart post.
Makes sense. Let me take the next one. So the question is about passing specific order information and private merchant information in a Google Wallet transaction. And I think we touched on this topic before. Most transact most wallet APIs gives you a way to add private merchant information and then mirror it back to you so that you can associate that information with the order. So since this does not mention the particular wallet API, let me talk about two of them that offer this capability. Okay, for the digital goods API, the in-app payment API, there is a field called seller data where you can pass private information. Probably it's a good idea to encrypt it. Then this information will be sent back to you in the post bag when the transaction completes, and you can use it to update your inventory, your user management information, everything there. And similarly, on the checkout side, there is a merchant private data field in the XML, merchant-private-data. You can search for it in the documentation, which behaves in a similar way, and you receive the same data back through the notification API. So two different APIs, similar methods to handle merchant information.
Yep. I'll take the next one. So how can I change the order page to get the customer on my site? And again, someone doesn't really talk about the API or what part of the order flow. So I'll answer all of the possibilities. First off, in checkout, well, there's no automatic redirects. Everything. So in order to get the customer back to your page, the customer needs to take action. If it's during the initial checkout flow where they're still viewing the order on checkout, you can define an edit cart URL, and then that'll create a link on the purchase page, on the checkout page, that'll allow the user to go back to your site to edit the items in their cart. Once the user has completed the purchase, you can define a continue shopping URL, which will define a link to direct the customer back from the receipt page to your site. But if you're only selling digital goods, you can use the in-app payments API or Google Wallet for digital goods, where the entire flow takes place on your site, and you won't have any of these problems.
Yeah, much easier.
Yeah. Hope that answers.
Yes. All right, there's another one about pricing. Do you want to take them?
Oh, yeah. So this one is actually from Stack Overflow. And it's a little bit untechnical for Stack Overflow, but we answered it anyway. In Google Wallet, I set the price in US dollars, but I'm selling digital goods, and my customer might be anywhere in the world. Is there any way to see what Google Wallet will charge on localized currency? So this is kind of the opposite concept of how Google Wallet works. Instead of you setting a fixed price as a merchant and then expecting Google Wallet to translate it across various currencies, well, how it actually works is that you set a fixed price in that currency, and then we translate it to US dollars or whatever your merchant account is in, and then pay you out in that amount. So it's the opposite, and what you should do is IP geolocate your customer, then define the market price of the item in the geolocated currency and enable your customer to purchase that way. With that, instead of maybe like one day a customer gets charged this, 5 cents, and the next day your customer gets charged 25 cents. It's just a fixed amount the entire time, and then that risk, that currency conversion risk is handled on your side.
Okay. Let me take the next one. This is also checkout related. Oh, that's quite a few of checkout questions.
Yeah.
And it says, I'm using the checkout notification XML API, and Google seems to be delivering notifications not in the order I expected. For example, an order state change notification will have a new financial order state of charging, and then immediately after one preceding it, it had already set it to charge. So order notifications may come out of order, and especially for the order state changes. The only checkout notification that is guaranteed to arrive in order is the new order notification, which will arrive first. So you'll get that one, and then you may get some order state changes notification in not the order you're expecting. Your solution sounds fine. Setting the state of the order to the order state notification with the high serial number is okay.
And I'll take the last question. Is it possible to cancel a subscription for a user without issuing a refund? So there was some confusion about
cancellations of subscriptions and whether that would automatically refund the subscription amount or the latest charge. And we want to clarify that canceling a subscription, well, all it does is it prevents the recurrences from occurring. So if there was an initial amount tied to that subscription initiation, then you can also refund that amount. But canceling the subscription won't refund the subsequent orders. So if you want to refund each of the subsequent recurrences, you'll have to go into those recurrences and then cancel and refund those.
All right. Any more questions? Or we got to the end?
I think that's it.
That's it. Well, lots of checkout questions. People are getting ready to sell stuff.
Yeah.
For New Year and Christmas and all the winter holidays. So we hope you make money. Great. So this, as we said earlier, this is our last show for this year. Yep. And we will see everyone back in 2013. We want to wish you a Happy New Year.
Yep. Happy Holidays.
Happy Holidays. And we'll see you in 2013.
See ya.
Bye.